My name is Mikal Mayer, and the problem we're targeting is that most of people on Earth are not users of computers, but they are not programmers at all, or there are very few programming expertise. And if I let's open your email, not your email, just in the demo. If you receive an email, sometimes you need to process it because you are a data scientist and you need to perform extraction. So you open your Word, you do some search, then you figure out how to use not.++ regular expressions. You open up your Excel browser, your Excel spreadsheet, so that you can use all these cool formulas. You find, you replace, you use these functions, and then you use all this wonderful toolbox. But then, when it goes, and you need to repeat this again because you get other emails, then it becomes hard. So, one of the aspects of programming example that Henry Lieberman underlined in 2001 is that it can give ordinary users the ability to write programs while still operating in a familiar user interface. And I look on Google, and what I found is that for more than 20 years, programming example doesn't work, is not available, etc. So there was an exception. Flashfield in 2013 released as an Excel feature. And it's very cool. You write your column, you give some example of your output, you press Control E, and it also completely fills instantaneously the result on the right. So this is programming by example. A very good initial response, the best feature in Excel that should have been available a long time ago. But then there were some problems with Flashfield. It was named as one of the most controversial features in Excel 2013. Advised to be very careful. Why? There may be exceptions that you don't notice unless you examine the result very carefully. There was another product of Microsoft this year, which was a control form string, where you could extract a list of objects out of a template where you would kind of highlight things. Then the most valuable professionals of Microsoft had a very nice reaction. This is super cool. One of the best improvements that came with Microsoft Management Framework. And then one of the bloggers said, oh, we're running into an issue in the extraction. We look at the debug output. This is a debug output. And his conclusion was, if you can understand this, you are a better person than I am. And it was a most valuable professional. So Tesalo underlined that while these PBE systems have resulted in many publication AI venues, none of the technologies have yet achieved widespread adoption. Usability remains a critical barrier to their success. So now I will speak about usability and how our demo differs from previous work. So this is a demo. It's not live. It's just a set of screenshots, so that I'm sure it works. And I open a file, which is a source of Super Bowl games taken from Wikipedia. And you can see that it's just a very structured text file, and I want to extract a list of a spreadsheet out of this. So I start to highlight two examples, then I wait for a while, and then it will give me this output. As you can see, on the right, there are Super Bowl 3, 4, and 5, which are missing. So this is very problematic in programming the example because it always happens. The specification is not complete enough. So our first user interaction model is program viewer. So we can have a look at the program and understand why it was not working. And this program highlights in plain paraphrased English what the logic is. And we can hover it to see what the structure is. And then at the end, we hover a regular expression, which appears in the left document. And now we can understand why it was not extracting the third one. It's because there is a comment at the end of the source file. So this is why it was not able to extract it. But now we can do better than this. If I can just highlight the example, run it again, and then it gives me the right program. But now, let's come back to the same program. Now what I can do is I can go to the program viewer and select a different program. So you see this small arrow on the right. So if I click on it, it will show me all the lines ending with this regular expression, and there are different alternatives to this. So I can hover some of the alternatives, and one of them actually gives me an example that will add me the third one. So I can click on it. it's at the example, and then I can inspect the output, and then it works. So it was one user interaction model, and now let's go back to the beginning, and there is another one which we developed. Instead of going to all this program and find out which one is the best, which is, can be very long if the program is big, this time we go to disambiguation. And disambiguation actually runs many programs in parallel and will output the first discrepancy between programs so that I just need to, in one click, to see where the difference is and select which one's correct. So in this case, I would select the second one because it is correct. Then it's looking for other ambiguity, so I can just select the correct one, and then I get all the 49 Super Bowl games. So why it can be useful? Let's go towards the second example. So I will highlight now the winning team of the Super Bowl game. So the winning team was first the Green Bay Packers. Then the second winning team was the Green Bay Packers. I let it run. It doesn't find anything else, so I highlight a third example, the New York Jets. And now you see that it extracted visibly correctly the winning team. No, there is a problem with this instruction. And if I were not American, I am not American, I would never be able to spot this. Why? Because if you go to disambiguation, you find that the team of San Francisco is not San Francisco, but San Francisco 49ers. So in this case, he was able to find two programs. He selected the first one, which obviously is not correct, but it gives me the option to select the second one. And when I click on it, then it will ask me a few questions, investigating some other ambiguities, which I can just answer with a matter of one click. And at the end, there is no more disambiguation. So let me give you tell you how it works under the hood. So we want to meet some criterion. So we want to detect failure and fail gracefully and make it easy to correct the system. So this one of the problems addressed by your system. But then, for the paraphrasing, we had the two challenges. We want a model that user can understand. And for example, you have the char one. This is what programming by example would output normally as a program. So we had a way of specifying templates so that the char one becomes the beginning, char two becomes the second char, and char minus three is the third char from the end. But sometimes it's, you can have very long programs which should be very simple. For example, this one is post pair, post line one, and minus one, which in English would say extract the string between the beginning of the second line and the end of second line. You get it? Normally, it should be the second line. So we design a set of idioms. We have more than 80 idioms. And that way, and then it becomes extract the second line. So it makes it more easy to people to observe. So now let me explain the magic behind the disambiguation or conversational clarification, as we call it. So we have the program, the input, and the output. This is how we represent the program for now. Normally, you don't have just one program found by programming by example. You have a huge program set, and they are distributed in unions and distributed in joints. So a program can be composed of several programs. And even when you have several joints, they can be composed of multiple unions. So from this, you can enumerate the programs, and actually you can have these billions of programs. So we need a better way to run all of them. So we design a way that we rank the program so that we output the first program. And then we can enumerate the other programs that are almost like the best program, but differ by exactly one other program. And we take the two best program variants, but in practice we take the 10 best program variants. So now I highlight two examples, Mikal and Gustavo, and then I compute the best program, I run it, and I get this output. Now I run other programs, and I get this output. So we perform a simple comparison, and we compare the output, and then we are able to ask a question. And if we run several programs, we might have different outputs, or we can even let the user write his custom example. So you had a lot of code boxes. This is a black box because at the end, we can just click on one of the answers, and it goes back to the example, and the user can loop over this. So we set up a user study to find out how much useful it is. So with 29 participants, with two females, and three tasks with ambiguities and three conditions. So one of them didn't have anything, the second one had conversational clarification, and the third one has program navigation, as we call it in the paper. So we gave them an array, like this one, and we asked them to highlight the file that it has given, so that they can produce the array and everything that is described on the header line. And we found out three results out of this user study. The first one is that the correctness increases when we turn on either one of the two features, program navigation or conversational clarification. So let me show you the number of errors. So without a new feature, the people get 2 to 4 errors in approximately, but with conversational clarification and program navigation, they get much less errors. Then we got to two new other laws. The first one is that conversational clarification is perceived more useful than program navigation. And if you attended the demo yesterday, everybody told me that this is more useful. So he got a best score. And we got some quotes, like the program is quite understandable, but it's not clear how to modify the program. Actually, most of the users didn't even try to modify the program. And conversational clarification itself, it increases confidence in the programming by example system. So this is really something that we missed over the previous programming by example technologies. So it got a pretty weak score, but that is still statistically significant. And one of the quotes was in the last example where somebody didn't have the conversational clarification, she felt that she missed it so much. And another one said, it always helped me to find the right matching. So this is now an SDK that has been released by Microsoft 2 weeks ago, so everybody can use it, and you will get this technology, a flash fill, a flash extract for free. I encourage you to visit the website, and now I will be happy to take any questions if you have. Thank you very much.
Hi, Ken Arnold at Harvard. So I'm intrigued by this, the way that you're able to make paraphrases of code into English. I realize that's kind of a program that you are trying yourself to author by examples. Just curious if you've tried your system to author parts of your system.
Can you repeat?
The paraphrases where you take a block of code and output a simpler English sentence that describes it. Mm-hmm. That strikes me as a program that you might have to develop from lots of examples.
Oh,
have you tried?
Okay, why the question is, how does it come that with so few examples we get such a big program that is so complicated? So the answer is that we are dealing with a domain-specific language here that has been designed and engineered based on many examples. So this is why we are able to figure out this program. Then actually, when you give an example like this one, what happens is that you give a position, a start position and end position. So these two positions, as soon as you give two of them, you will create the intersection of all the possible programs. And this is how you can retrieve a program which looks complex. Actually, so this is the story behind this, and I had something, So if you have a look at this slide, this is a real program that you would get at the end. But what's really interesting is that you have some regular expressions that have been computed. There are like 60 regular expressions in the back end. And there are like a few functions that help to define the relative start or end position. Thank you.
Yeah, so this is definitely good for debugging, but the simplicity is lost, I think, you know. Flash fill or smart fill, just use regular spreadsheet, no additional screen. But here, you have lots of widgets, screens, tabs. Do you think it's realistic to integrate this into something like Excel, or what do you think?
We're thinking about that because one of the problems with flash fill, as I underline it, is that it works if you have 100 lines. If you have 10,000 lines or even 1,000 lines, and you have a financial analyst, then you might get into troubles if you don't trust the data. So you need to have a way to trust the data. So this, instead of having a separate type, we could imagine to be like a small message in blue over yellow, or just as a pop-up as an assistant, that if you want, you can use it. If you don't, you can just leave it and trust the data.
I see. So this is for a big thing.
Yeah, it's okay. When you want to scale to big things. Yeah, right.
Wolfgang Stößlinger, Simon Fraser University. So you always give two choices?
No, actually you can have more choices.
Ah. Yeah, because that's kind of constraining. And you know, what if the right choice is the third choice, right?
So this happens in practice. You can have, in the demo I gave yesterday, sometimes you have three, four choices because of the same possibility of highlighting. In this case, we present all of them. We didn't find any example in which you had 10 choices, it's always less than 5 choices. So it's easy. Thank you.